Yeah. Now I'm talking about MBA accreditation and the Tier 2 format. When I say that, you know, Tier 2 formats, in case if any people, if they want to go for the accreditation for the non-autonomous college, they have to go for the Tier 2 format. In case if your college is a autonomous college, then they have to go for the Tier 1 format. Now, generally, you know, people will say that there is a question called, I mean, frequently asked question about the MBA accreditation question. So there is a question called, do you need a MBA accreditation? The answer is yes. In order to get the recognition or sometime to get the more benefit from the government or even ACT. Like, you know, you can proudly say that our programs are accredited by MBA. It is maybe 3 years or 6 years. Even if you want to increase the intake or fee structure to, I mean, a fee structure and a fees improvement, you can also. Okay. Yeah. Now, there is another question. Does MBA give accreditation for the college? The answer is no. Generally, some colleges, you know, they will say that our college is accredited by MBA. Even some our department is accredited by MBA. That is wrong. MBA will never will give the accreditation for the college. MBA will give accreditation for only for a program. It may be the B computer science or MTech computer science, or it may be the diploma, like computer science like that. They are not giving for the department or college. Now, there is another question. In a single application, how many programs we can apply for the MBA accreditation? The answer is that maximum, you know, in a single application, you can submit the 5 programs. In the sense, when I say the programs, BTech computer science is a program, BTech electronics is another program like that. You can, in a single application, you can submit the maximum 5 application. There is another question. In a single application, shall we apply MBA accreditation for the multiple programs like a BTech computer science, BTech electronics, MCA, MTech computer science? The answer is yes. You can apply different program, but the only thing is that in a single application, maximum programs, you can go 5 programs. There is another question. Our institution is autonomous college. Shall we use a Tier 2 format for MBA accreditation? In the sense, your college is autonomous college. Even more than 2 to 3 batches, it's already passed out from the autonomous stream. He's asking, shall we go for the Tier 2 format? The answer is no. Since your institution is autonomous, then more than 2 program is already passed out from the autonomous streams, then you are supposed to use only a Tier 1 format. A Tier 2 format can be used only for affiliated college, even not more than 2 programs, batches is passed out. There is another question. How many years the validity we can claim from the MBA accredited program? In the sense, our program is accredited by MBA. How many years we can expect the validity? The answer is that for UG program, the PG programs, MBA, MPharm, portals, diploma get 3 years accreditation. Even sometimes 6 years accreditation also you'll get. Whereas in MCA program, you'll get 2 years or 5 years accreditation. There is another question. What is the duration of the MBA regular visit? They will spend at the college level or department level. The answer is that if the number of programs is applied by the college is more than 2, in a sense, more than 2 programs are applied by the college for the accreditation purpose, then the visit duration is 3 days. In case if the number of program is less than 2, in a sense, 2 programs, if they went for the accreditation in a single application, then the 2 days visit only. There is another question. Does MBA need the ratification from the university for all appointment, like a professor, associate professor, assistant professor? In JNTUK, there is a provision for the ratification. The answer is that not necessary for all the appointments. However, your qualification experience should be as per the ACT norms or UGC norms. There is another question. What is the SFR value? For example, 1:15 or 1:20, 1:25, we have to keep. The answer is that regarding the SFR, don't mix with ACT norms with NBA norms. ACT talks about the ACT talks about the programs, whereas MBA talks about the department while calculating the SFR. In order to getting the 3 years MBA accreditations, SFR value should be below 25, average of 3 years. In the sense, CFI, CFO minus one, CFO minus two for the department we'll calculate. In order to get the 6 years MBA accreditations, the SFR value should be below 15, average of three academic year, CFI, CFO minus one, CFO minus two for the department. There is another question. Our college is autonomous college, but not a single batch, means UG, has under autonomous streams. Which format we have to use? The answer is, you have to go for the Tier 2 format, since MBA gives option for you to go under Tier 2 format. There is another question. Does MBA consider the all the first year faculty member in the core department while calculating the SFR value? As of now, no. SFR value is calculated for the department, excluding the first year faculty member. SFR value is equivalent to number of students with respect to second year, third year, final year, and PG. If you have one PG program, then first year PG, second year PG. If you have another PG, then that first year student, second year also you have to add, divided by number of faculty members, excluding the first year teaching workload. Now, there is another question, whom to be considered as a contractual faculty? The answer is that the faculty member who are getting the consolidated salary, or the faculty member who are appointed as a ad hoc faculty for a particular period or temporary period, those faculty will consider as a contractual faculty. There is another question. Do we need consider the part-time faculty member while calculating the SFR value? The answer is no. Part-time faculty, even hourly-based faculty, we will not consider. There is another question. Does MBA consider the principal director as a faculty while calculating the SFR value in the department? The answer is no. There is another question. Does MBA consider the age limit for the visiting faculty member? The answer is no. There is no age limit for the visiting faculty member, as long as he fit the to handle the classes. There is another question. Whom to be considered as a faculty member while calculating the SFR value? The answer is the faculty member who joined or not before August of the same year. That particular faculty has to continue till 30 of the April subsequently. For example, if I want to consider any faculty for the year 2018-19, in a sense, that particular faculty he has to join on or before 2018, he has to work till to the April 2019. Let us assume that if any faculty, if he joined in the month of October, then we will not consider. If any faculty, if he resigned in the month of February, also we will not consider them. And there is another question. What is the minimum qualification is needed for a faculty member? The answer is a master degree in engineering, or it may be the technology, or equivalents as per the ICT norms or UGC norm for the engineering department. Whereas in science and humanities departments, the qualification is MSc, MA, or equivalence degree, which is recognized by the ACT as per the norms. Now, there is another question. Does MBA recognize the degree from the Deakin University or abroad university? The answer is yes, as long as ACT or UGC recognize this degree, then MBA doesn't have any problem. There is another question. Does MBA consider the lecturer post in the department or program? The answer is no. As per the ACT norms or UGC norms, if you take in sixth pay or even seventh pay, there is no post called lecturer. So even if there are any people are holding the lecturer post, they will not consider them as assistant professor. Now there is another question. What do you mean the academic here? The academic here, yeah, Madan Vara Rao, sir, you have to give for him. Sir Kiran, sir. Hello.
Sir, I have given permission, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, what is the criteria for the ratification of post?
What is the
criteria for the ratification of post?
Sir, that's why I'm saying, no, it's vary from the university to university. We do, yeah, MBR, even ACT also will not expect anything, sir. But what we want to say that if your qualification is as per the ACT norms, we don't have any problem, sir.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
Right. For academic year, start with July, end with June. For the, for example, if you take in 2018-19, it start with July 2018, end with June 2019. There is another question. Does does MBA consider the contractual faculty member who are in the full-time basis in academic year while calculating the SFR? The answer is yes. The faculty member who served two consecutive semester in a same correspond academic year on the full-time basis, then they will consider. There is another question. Let's assume that our programs is accredited by MBA for the 3 years under Type 2 formats. Next 6 months, our accreditation period validity is about to expire. Then shall we submit the fresh SAR to the MBA? The answer is no need to submit the fresh SAR. You can submit the compliance report of accredited programs. There is another question. Does MBA consider the PG faculty member in the departments while calculating the SFR value? The answer is yes. SFR value is calculated for the department, including the PG, including PG faculty member, excluding the first year faculty member. I want to say here, I mean, excluding first year faculty workload, not a first year faculty workload, first year faculty workload. The SFR value is equal to total number of students, second year, third year, finally of the UG, first year PG, second year PG. In case if you have multiple PG, then you all PG student, you have to add it divided by total number of faculty member. There is another question. Shall MBA consider the associate professor without PhD degree? The answer is no. As per the ACT norms, UGC norms, with respect to qualification and experience, you should follow the, because there is no, I mean, without PhD degree, you cannot allow any people move professor level, even a direct recruitment, no, they will not allow also. There is a chat message, some message I'm getting here.
No, sir, I have a question, sir. You can continue, sir.
Yes, sir, yes, sir. Yeah. Now, during the regular MBA visit, how many MBA expert committee members will visit to the department? Yeah, the answer is, if it is a UG program or PG program, then number of MBA expert committee they will visit to. If it is a diploma program, then the number of MBA expert member is one. Let's assume that there is another question. Let's assume that a department is having a two shifts, shift one and BE programs, and we're also having a second shift BE computer science program also. Do you need to count the all first year, first shift, second shift students while calculating the SFR? The answer is yes. MBA gives for the accreditation for a program, not for the shift basis. So SFR value is a total number of students in the department. It may be first year, first shift or second shift divided by a total number of faculty member for the first shift, second shift. Now, with respect to pre-qualifier, you are supposed to fill 8 conditions. This 8 condition you have to fulfill. I'll go in details here. Now, condition 1, if any program, if you are going for MBA accreditation, first you should have a vision, mission, PO. In the sense, the department which you are going for MBA accreditation, with respect to that particular department, you should have a vision, you should have a mission. The program which you are going for accreditation, that particular program should have a PEO. When you are opening the MBA portal pre-qualifier, you will get this is option. Here you have an option called yes or no. Select yes, no. There are three options you have. So you have to select the yes option. Now, condition two, approval of the ACT is needed for a program for COI, CO minus one, CO minus two. In a sense, if any program, if you are going for MBA accreditation, three consecutive years, when COI, CO minus one, CO minus two, ACT approval is required. Let us assume that B computer science programs, you are going for the MBA accreditation. In that case, 3 years, MBA accreditation approval is, ACT approval is required. So you have here you have option only, select yes or no. Now, condition three, it says that at least 50% of the seats with respect to all UG programs of 3 years, the seats has to be filled at the, I'm taking that 300, in the sense 1920, you have Samsung Intake 300, next year, you know, 2017-18, 300. So total sanctioning for the past 3 years is 900. In the sense, I am assuming that five programs, because of five, each program, I am assuming that your intake is 60. Let's assume that like that. Number of students is admitted with respect to all program is, your sanction intake at the college level is 300, but admitted is 280. Here you have to take only for UG, not for PG or MCA. So with respect to 18-19, your sanction intake is 300, but is admitted 284. So here 17-18, admitted is 280, but sanction is 380. So what you have to do is 849 divided by 900, how much? 94.3. So in order to submit the pre-qualifier, you have required only 50%. But if you are, your admission is 94.3, so then you are eligible for the pre-qualifier. That's meaning of that. Now, condition four, at least 50% of the seat has to be filled at the program level for the COI, CO minus one, CO minus two. Means you will take average of 3 years here. Let's assume that your B computer science program sanction intake is 60. 60 here, 2019-20, your sanction intake 60, but admitted is 53. Your 18-19 is sanction intake 60, but admitted is 50. 17-18 sanction intake 60, but admitted is 50. So here, to past 3 years, your sanction is 180. When it says 60 plus 60 plus 60, it is 180. So, but admitted is 53 plus 54 plus 50, it is 160. So 160 divided by 180, it is 88.89. So one of the eligibility criteria is that average of 3 years, 50% seat has to be filled. Then you are getting 88.89. So you are this condition also, it will be clear. Now, when you're talking about the condition five, it talks about the student faculty ratio in the program should be less than 25, average of 3 years. CFI, CO minus one, CO minus two. Now, for example, SFR value, you are calculating 2019-20. For example, you take 2019-20. So I am assuming that, see, when you're calculating the SFR value, you have to take second year, third year, final year students only. So your second year sanction intake is 120. Sanction is 120, but here, you know, in that particular batch, you know, your admitted is means through later entry, you know, it is 19. So total number of students, you know, for with respect to here, the second year, third year, this is the final year. So this is sanction intake 360, but how many number of students are admitted? Like the with respect to 18-19, your sanction is 120, but admitted is 24. But how many number of students actually admitted you can give like that here? But sanction intake, no, you have to give a full. But whereas admitted student through letter entry, no, the value may be vary. So here, in case if you have any PG programs, then you should also add those students also. Now I am assuming that total number of students in the department is 360 plus 67. How much? 470 in the sense with respect to 427. I'm assuming that in your department there are nearly 23 faculties are there. So 427 divided by 23, it comes 18.57. So you have to calculate for the COI, COO minus 1, COO minus 2. When you do all the things, you're getting 21.37 because you have to take the average of 3 years. Now, in order to get the pre-qualifier, your SFR value should be less than 25. So now how much of value you are getting here? 21.32. So you're eligible for the pre-qualifier. This is one of example. Yeah, when I say that here is 23, which is excluding first year workload. Now, another condition six. At least one regular professor is required, or Krishnamurthy, what is his name? His name I forgot. Sir, some one guys. Yeah, two people.
1 minute, sir.
Huh?
1 minute, sir. Krishnamurthy,
sir. Sir.
Sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, in the previous slide, we discussed about the SFR ratio.
Yes, sir.
So we are having some problems, sir, in that.
Okay.
So our admitted sanctioned intake is 180, sir.
180, yes.
We are getting only less number of students.
Sir, I understood what you want to convey to me. Your sanction is 120. Even though if a student is not admitted, this value cannot be changed. It should be 180, 180, 180 only. This value should be 540.
Okay, sir.
With respect to actual admitted student, you can put zero, if at all if you require. And one more thing I want to say to you. In your JNTUK, there is some provision is there. If any student is left out in first year, you can admit in second year.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, in that case, this is 180. If you are admitted second year, then how many number of students you are admitted here, that second year, that value will come here.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, here, one more doubt, sir.
Yes, sir.
So we are in the lateral entry, we are getting the number more than the sanctioned. Suppose if you're taking 180 as intake, so lateral entry student should be 36.
Yeah, that's why, sir. There, in your state, there is a provision. Left out seats in first year, you can fill it. But MBA, if your sanction year is 180, plus how many number of students is admitted here? No, you just add it.
Yes, sir. But it's increasing total intake, sir.
Yes, sir.
The total intake.
Yes, yes, sir.
So in that case, SFR is not in the safe zone.
Yeah, your SFR may be crossing in 25 also.
In that, how we can answer to the expert, sir?
No. There is no. See, while entering the pre-qualifier itself, we'll come to know that there is some problem is there.
Yes, sir.
In the sense that why one of the eligibility criteria, I think you will come to know next time. Because, in first year, how many number of students are admitted?
Yes, sir.
From there also, you'll come to know that one.
Okay, sir.
Yes, sir. Some of the other people also, they raise the hands. Any other question? Hello? Sir, can I proceed? Hello? Yeah, sir. Some Raja Babu. Sir Kiran, sir.
Sir, unmuted, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, by mistake, sir, you please carry on.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
One second. Yeah. Now, with respect to here, condition six, there are two things, condition A, condition B. At least one regular professor is required, or at least one regular associate professor is required for the with respect to department. But whether he may be professor or he may be associate professor, he need PhD degree in the department for the two consecutive years, means COI, CO minus one. For example, you take there. But here, even 2017-18, if you don't have a PhD, no problem. But with respect to COY, you require at least one PhD is required with respect to this example. Let us assume that at least one PhD holder must be regular PhD member in case the required faculty is 10. The meaning of this one. In the sense, with respect to these two assessment here, at least one PhD is required. But here with respect to this example, you have two PhD, then you don't have any problem. Now, condition 7, number of available PhD in the department is greater than or equivalent to 10% of the required faculty member average of 2 years. In the sense, for the COY, CO minus 1. Let us assume that in BE computer science program, total number of students is 400. Means second year, third year, final year. Means total number of students is 400. Second year, third year, final year. Then the required faculty member is 400 divided by 20. So you require 20. So 10% in the sense, 20 multiplying to 0.10. So you require 2. Actually, you require 10% means 2 required, but you have 2. So no problem. So you are also here. In this case also, you are eligible. I mean, it will be cleared the pre-qualifier. Now, condition 8. At least 2 batch student has to be passed. In a sense, if at all, if you want to go for the MBA accreditation, at least 2 batch student has to be passed. In a sense, like if 2018-19 batch or 2017-18 batch, at least 2 student has to pass out. So all 8 condition have to be satisfied before submitting SAR. So once, if all the conditions are satisfied, then you, from the portal, you know, you will get like that, compile like that. In case any one of the condition, you know, if you're not fulfilled, then system, you know, backend automatically the red flag it displays. For example, you know, this is the red flag. It says that your admission is undergraduate programs under consideration has more than or equal to 50. So you are not compiled like that. You'll get answer like that. Yeah. Now, list of the criteria as well and marks distribution. So with respect to type 2 format, you know, you have a 10 criteria. Each criteria, you know, the marks distribution, you know, it is not the same. It's vary from the criteria 2 to criteria. With respect to 80 marks will be evaluated by the evaluator from the criteria 1 to criteria 6. So with respect to criteria 8 to criteria 10 will be evaluated by chairman. So it will be carry the 220 marks. Now, sometimes, you know, people will say that we went to MBA accreditation, but we didn't get the accreditation. The reason is that if your program get less than 600 marks out of 1000 marks, for example, you know, you got 599. So there is no concept called the grace mark. So if at all, if you want to get accreditation, you require at least 600 marks. So grace mark, you know, some your university, you know, will give the, if any two students, if you fail, then you can leave that one, you can get the degree, but MBA will not give like that. So if at all, if you want to get accreditation, you require 600 marks, then only you are eligible for the accreditation. And even student faculty ratio in the program, if it is going above 25, then also you are not eligible. So I will give small example by considering all these things. Now, I already told that condition 1, if any program score less than 600 marks out of 1000 marks, then you are not getting accreditation. Condition 2, your SFR value, you know, if it is shoot above the 25, then you are not eligible for the MBA accreditation for with respect to your program. When student faculty ratio in the program is above 25% average of 3 years, COY, CO minus 1, CO minus 2. Here with respect to here, let us assume that's in BE computer science programs for the year 2019-20, your SFR value is 432 divided by 15. I am assuming that in your department, there are 15 faculty are there, excluding first year faculty member. Then what is the value here for SFR? 28.5. So 28, remaining 2018-19, your SFR is 27. 2017-18-9, your SFR is 24. If you take average of 3 years, it is going 26.5. So because of when you, because you know, here, you know, it's crossing more than 25, then the, if your SFR is like that, then you are not eligible for the, you will not get accreditation. Now, how you got 432? Here, I'm giving one example. For example, in the year of 2018, 19, your sanction intake is 120, but actually your admitted letter entry is 24, like that. So if you do take, you know, 432, you get number of students. In case if there is no letter entry students, you directly put zero. No, nothing will happen. In that case, it will be, we will take only a 360, not a 24. Of course, letter entry, there is some percentage, but due to some reason, students are not joined. So you just give only sanction intake. If there is no students are admitted, means through letter entry, you put zero. But sanction intake, you have to take. Condition three, if the program scores less than 40% of the 200 marks in criteria five, then you are not eligible for the MBA accreditation. For example, BE Computer Science program, you score 78 marks out of 200 marks in the criteria five. So then there is no accreditation. I already told that with respect to MBA point of view, criteria five, it's very, very powerful. So I can say that it is hard. So if at all, if you want to get an accreditation, then at least you have to maintain the 40%. In the sense, 80 marks is required. Now, sometimes people will say that we got 3 years accreditation. Why you will get 3 years accreditation? You have to fulfill the five conditions. I will explain in detail here. Now, condition one, at least one regular professor is required or one associate professor is required with PhD for the department in this CAY CAO minus one. Let's assume that in BE Computer Science program, intake is 120, letter entry is 24. I am assuming that in the department, all the seats are filled. In the sense, your sanction intake is 120, 24 seats are filled through letter entry. In case if 24 seats are not filled, then you put zero. 120 plus zero, you can fill like that. And no PG program is offering in the departments. And then total number of students is 432. In the sense, first year, second year, 144, third year is 144, and final year student, 144. So totally how much is comes here, it is nearly 432. So required faculty member is 432 divided by 20. So in your department, you require 21.6. So there is a formula. The required number of professor is that 21.6 required number of faculty divided by 9 means you have to formula one. You have to apply the ACT norms. 2 divided by 9 required. I mean number of faculty required to compliance with 20:1. So 2 by means required number of faculty. How much you required here, professor? 21.6 divided by 9. So you require 2.4. Whereas in associate professor, 2 by 9 into required faculty. What is the required faculty here? 21.6 here. So you required 4.8. With respect to associate professor, 6 by 9 required number of faculty, 21.6. So you got 14.4. Now, I want to say that, see, no need to go exactly 4.8. So you can go lowest truncate value. In the sense, actually, you with respect to professor point of view, you required 2.4, but you put only 2. In the sense, you take the lowest truncate value. Even 2.9, the lowest truncate is 2 only. So with respect to here, associate professor, you required 4.8, but lowest truncate value is here is 4. Some people say that kindly open.
You continue, sir.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Now, with respect to student faculty ratio in the program should be below 25, average of 3 years. CAY, CAO minus one, CAO minus two. Let's assume that a BE Computer Science program intake is 120 and letter entry, it is 24. Here, I'm assuming that in computer science departments, all the seats are filled, including the sanction seat also filled, even letter entry also it is filled. So here, that second year, intake is total number of students is 144 with respect to 2018-19. With respect to 2018-19, third year also 144 and final year also 144. So total number of students with respect to year 2018-19 is 432. I am assuming that in your department, there are nearly 30 faculty members are there, excluding the first year workload. In the sense, 432 divided by 30, it is a 14.4. In order to get the 3 years accreditation, your SFR value should be average of 3 years should be 25 only. So now you are getting average of 3 years, you are getting 14.4. Then this condition also you are fulfilling. Now, condition 3, at least 10% of the average required faculty with PhD for the COI, COI minus 1 with the ratio of 1:20. Here, I already told that U1 is nothing but second year, U2 is third year, U3 is the final year. So total number of students is 432. So 432, as per the ACT now, what it says that, you know, you have to follow 1:20. So 432 divided by 20, how much? 21.6. So required faculty member with respect to your department is required is 21.6. Here I'm assuming that in your department, there is no PG program. So 10% in the sense required PhD is 20%. So here 2.16 plus 2.6, because if you have to take COI, COI minus one. So 2.16 plus 21.6. So here, it will be average of, if you take, you know, 2.16 only, but here, you know, it is, you have to take the lowest truncate value, in the sense, of course is required 2.16, but the lowest truncate value, you have to take it, you means two value. So here also, actually in your department required is 2.16, but available PhD with respect to your department, you have a 3. So now you don't have any problem to get a 3 years accreditation. Now, condition 4. Program should be scored more than or equal to 600 marks out of 1,000 marks. So with respect to here, whichever the criteria, if you want to get more marks, it is left to you. But criteria 5, because of, you know, you have to maintain at least 40%, means 80 marks is required. Remaining criteria, how many marks you get, nothing. But criteria 5, minimum 40% is marks you have to get. So total marks, you know, you have to get the 600 marks to get the accreditation. Condition 5, in criteria 5, marks should be more than or equal to 40% of the marks. I already told that in this criteria, you should maintain at least minimum 40%. 40 in the sense, 200 into 0.4, so it is 80 marks is required. So that's all. Because, you know, 5 years accreditation, I don't think it's required for you, because of you can find there are only few colleges in India to get the 6 year accreditation, because it's only like even NITs, they got the 6 year accreditation. They got only 3 years accreditation. Some of the NIT, even there are some colleges like BMS, we got 5 years accreditation for some of the program, like BE Electronics, we got it. Even MTech Computer Science program, we got. Even College of Engineering also, they got the 6 years accreditation.